Recently, I made a video painting the miniature Failheim from Lazy Squire Games' board game Storm Thunder. An intimidating character and an intimidating paint job. The idea, to display both the quality of the sculpt and the detail level of the miniature, was sound. But it kind of got me thinking. A board game like Storm Thunder contains a multitude of miniatures. Boxes like these tend to. And not only for board games. Releasing boxes with a lot of miniatures has become a thing. For people into Games Workshop, we've recently been heavily weighted down with things like the Indomitus box, the Cursed City box, the Dominion box. With Storm Thunder, or any other board game for that matter, well, I mean, board games do have the tendency to be the entry point, the gate that when passed through reveals the wondrous world of miniature painting, the Narnia cupboard. But instead of wise lions and misplaced lamp posts, there's things like what paint goes where, and what's up with all these YouTube creators doing way too advanced tutorials on techniques I would never attempt. To that, I say, welcome, I hope you enjoy the stay. Emergency exits are at the rear, but we've run out of parachutes. Anyway, so we got this box, it's packed with minis, we want to play the game, but it would be kind of nice with some paint on there. As long as it doesn't take too long. Is that possible, please? And that is sort of going to be the subject of today's video. I'd like to talk efficiency. I don't like the word speed. Speed is an individual variable. Efficiency is constant. That said, there's no point in me covering too many beginner aspects already covered wonderfully by others. So if you are new here, recently arrived from the world where paint goes on walls and varnishing is something only done to nails, but now find yourself with a big old board game box packed with minis in your hand, I would warmly like to recommend Dana Howell's Hobby Basics as a great starting point. And then think of my additional information as the Kickstarter stretch goal you were just hoping for. Firstly, when it comes to board games, although this being totally dependent on the manufacturing process, the miniatures might still have something called release agent on them. A lubricant, we could call it. This helps the plastic miniatures release from the mold they were cast in during production. Usually a case with softer PVC plastic and resin miniatures. The residue release agent can mess with your paint, so a quick wash in lukewarm water with some washing up liquid and then a rinse can be a good thing before painting. Using some sort of a handle when painting is the thing I personally find handy. These can be bought or one can just use something handle-like, lying around. Not only does this help with my sometimes relatively shaky hands, but also means I don't have to inadvertently smudge paint around the miniature with my fingers. Priming is the first step of miniature painting, a step not worth skipping. An even layer of paint that the rest of your paint will just love to stick to instead of smearing around on the plastic surface of the miniature. Rattle can is the preferred method for many, unless one has access to an airbrush. Unfortunately, a tool that never seems to be included in any board game or war game box. Priming in itself can be a great efficiency box to take. If one is painting golden armored warriors or blue monsters, a thought could be put into actually priming the miniature in that color, if that color covers a relative majority of the miniature. There is also something called zenithal priming that I just want to mention, so that you can write it down on a now important piece of paper for future reference. I am today actually going to be priming with a light gray for reasons about to be dissected. Palettes are another thing to note down, a surface to put one's paint onto. Like with outdoor sports, there's the dry kind and the wet kind. These palettes can be bought or made. I'm using a sheet of baking tray paper on a flat surface as a dry palette to make cleaning up easier. I mean, just throwing away the baking tray paper. The wet palette is devised to keep paints moist while painting. The dry palette is for paints that don't like the moisture of the wet palette. This is also about to be dissected. But now let's get into some efficiency. I love to take my time using unending variations of shades of paint, painting details, lots of tiny brush strokes of thin paint, all relatively unplanned and spontaneous. Time consuming, yeah. So it becomes apparent to me that the key to being efficient is doing the opposite. Using a limited amount of colors that require limited detailed brushwork in a limited amount of layers with a thought-through plan of execution. And honestly, to me, this is pretty scary, but I'm no stranger to challenges. So first off, limiting color schemes. An allure with detailed miniatures is to paint every single detail with its own color. Not only does this create spontaneous brain freeze, what color to use where, but it also complicates the painting process. For every new color, there's a chance that that paint gets somewhere it's not meant to go. And we're supposed to limit the brushwork, remember? Sticking to two or three base colors is not impossible and can still look good. Limited layers of paint. Less onion. A basic paint job would consist of one to two layers of base colors. A wash, that's a type of transparent paint that runs into the recesses to add depth. Then maybe one of the base colors again, and then some form of highlight, either applied with fiddly brushwork or something called dry brushing. Another term for you to note, but also dissected later on. Multiply these factors with the amount of colors in your color scheme. Well, it all sounds relatively inefficient. And this is all still on the basic level. But then, somewhere, maybe in a cave, or even better, in a crumbling wizard's tower, an awfully chemically well-informed individual developed something called contrast paint, reducing our steps drastically. Something like a mix between a regular paint and a wash, transparent like a wash, but more pigmented, saturated, and with thicker consistency. Like jam compared to a cordial. And then there's the planning. The planning in this case not being scheduling who can take the dog for the walk or put the kids to bed so that the other individual involved can shake bottles of paint undisturbed. Well, it is now that I mention it, but more importantly in the planning of what paints to use and in what order to use them. Previously mentioned was the base coat. Can you get away with just priming something entirely with the red and then paint some silver on top and be done? Are there bits on a miniature that are really fiddly to get to and probably should be painted first so as not to smudge the rest? Can one choose paints that actually blend rather nicely so that smudging isn't really an issue? This will also all be dissected further ahead. Well, apart from the dog and definitely not the kids. It's time for the first actual product tip, related to the previously mentioned contrast paint, but with a twist. So we just bought the darn board game. Well worth its money, of course, but now there's all these paints, regular opaque paints, washes, contrast paints. Why not just try and reduce and enter stage left contrast medium? Contrast paint without pigment, without color. Enabling us to make our own contrast-style paint, or even a type of wash, out of regular paints. One tub to rule them all. And this is why I primed my miniatures with the light grey. I'm going to try and paint using a heretical mix of regular paints with contrast medium. Because of the nature of contrast paints, especially this homebrew mixture, the underlying base coat shines through and needs a relatively bright undercoat to work well. Light grey being a nice shade and the most common for contrast paints. Also, this contrast paint is the reason for my dry palette. Contrast paints don't really like water all that much. Deciding on a customary Anubis blue for this lovely, large, ceremonial sword-wielding monster. By the way, keeping a book like this of one's paints is a great thing. Not all that necessary when starting out, but it probably won't take all that long before there's quite a number of paints in your collection. The virtue of adding the contrast medium like this to a paint is that it flows out and sinks down into the recesses, giving a sense of depth. It also makes the paint flow real nice. And applying the paint is like spreading butter on toast, in a good way. This mix of contrast and regular paints will be a tad more dull than what you'd expect from a regular contrast paint because of the apparent dilution. A quick note though, the blue I chose for this scheme is already relatively dull, so here's just an example of what a more saturated blue mixed with contrast medium can look like. Anyway, I've decided to paint this mini blue and gold, very ancient Egypt-y inspired, and I've started with the blue. It doesn't really matter if I smudge this all over because the gold will be painted on with a regular opaque paint. That means not transparent. My gold layer will be where I have to pay attention and not get paint in the wrong places, but not so with the blue. Planning, you see. Adding a little black to the blue and then mixing with some contrast medium gives me a darker grey-blue that I paint on in some of the places where I want a bit more shadow and depth. Using a black instead of a darker blue is just to show in a way what we can do with a limited set of colours. Also, I hope my reason for having the wet palette is becoming apparent. The paints in there stay wet during this entire session and I can keep on using whatever's in there instead of having it dry on me like the stuff on the dry palette. I use a brown with some black in, diluted with contrast medium for all the leathery bits, clothy bits. The fun thing using the contrast medium is one can vary the dilution. The more contrast medium, the paler the color, but also the more it acts like a wash, seeping into the crevices kind of a thing. Oh, and I also kind of went for it and put some green on them, whatever they are. This is where it becomes apparent that using this mix of contrast medium, contrast paints in general, is not all that great in heavy multiple layers. The contrast effect is almost lost. But this is me not planning and reverting to my spontaneous ways. It won't happen again, I promise. Sort of. Then it's time for a dry brush. Dry brush is putting paint on a brush, wiping most of the paint off on a piece of paper to the point that there's hardly any visible paint coming off on the paper, and then dusting your miniature lightly, preferably from up top, stroking down. This will bring out details. The residue paint in the brush sticks mainly to the elevated details of the miniature. Brushing from top, stroking down, will mimic the natural light coming down from an imaginary sky above the miniature. I very much like to use large makeup brushes like this, but there's also specific dry brush type brushes one can buy. I'm using a stone grey paint, a grey with almost a hint of green. This because it will work out fine on both the blue and the brown. Planning, you see. And then it's time for gold. Being a very specific product, the metallic pigment powder from Green Stuff World are great when one wants a lovely metallic surface in just one layer of application. Being a pigment powder, it needs to be mixed with a medium to create a paint, and I'm using the Master medium from the same company. I didn't actually try and see if the contrast medium would have worked as a medium. In hindsight, kind of silly on me. This is in a way going to finish off my two-color scheme, the gold and the blue. But Anubis will like us just a bit more if a tad of depth and character is added. Doing a very simple mind exercise in color theory, I reached the conclusion that a brown, warm reddish wash would be a nice thing. Getting a brown reddish on the gold to give it some more character, but also it wouldn't matter if any of this got on the blue. The worst thing that could happen to the blue is a slight purple effect, and that might even be favorable. I used red, brown, and yellow, and quite a lot of contrast medium to create a thin paint that went over all the gold, painting without regard to all that much detailed application. Being quite fond of the purple effect, I mixed a dark purple by adding some blue to this red mixture and used this freely on the shaded areas of the gold and the blue. Once more, it's the planning thing here. Figuring out a color that looks good on all areas means I just don't have to pay any real attention to details. And there's no real way of accidentally getting paint in the wrong areas because there's no wrong areas. Like playing golf with nothing but one big hole in front of you. To finish off, I light-handedly dry brushed the gold to get some shine back, and painted the base with whatever paint was still in my wet palette. Mixes of brown, red, green, blue. This example, this miniature, I hope can display the theory of shortcuts. The point is not for this to be a specific blue and gold tutorial, but trying to exhibit the different steps of simplifying a paint job. Minimizing the steps, planning the choice of colors, the order of application, and that the specific choice of colors can not only lead to efficiency, but also enhance. I've used a limited amount of colors, and the contrast medium not only giving some favorable aesthetics, but also ease of application. The only actual detail-like brushwork on this entire miniature was the teeth and the eyes. Very simple, straightforward strokes of white on the teeth and two small blobs of orange for the eyes. The miniature took me probably about 45 minutes to paint. But being a relatively large Storm Sunder monster, it of course comes with minions. Minions usually are aplenty. So could I be even more efficient? Well, I have one last trick up my sleeve. First off, I gave this undead follower of Anubis-inspired large monster some silver details. Just picking out some of the most visible metallic bits, spear shaft, helmet, shoulder pad. Then I somewhat randomly used the paints already in my wet palette, dipped my brush in paint, then into a blob of contrast medium, and then onto the miniature. Not worrying at all about details, I tried to get more of a brown on the spear shafts and loincloth, and the rest got an unhealthy mix of paint that could in the end be described as zombie. This is sort of a technique called wet blending. In essence, mixing the paint on the miniature, creating all kinds of gradients and color shifts. Normally, when wet blending with regular opaque paint, there would be more of a point of getting specific paints in specific places. Not so here. After all that was dry, I dry brushed the non-metallic-y bits with the stone grey quite heavily, and also dry brushed the silver with some more silver. And now for the fun bit, oil paints. I'd say that using oil paints should be something considered by all new to the hobby, because then you'll, unlike me, be without bias as to why not to use it. I think there's like an invisible wall built up by the fact that oil paint most oftenly is not sold at game stores and that it's not water soluble. Now, if white spirit, which we often use to dilute oil paint with, in my case I'm using an odorless version, seems daunting, well, it's of course good and required to read up on safety and precautions, but also think, what if you took an art class? And the teacher said, today we're going to paint with oil paints, like the old masters. Would you refuse? Or like for me, that during childhood only painted miniatures with enamel paints and thinner. I mean, I turned out perfectly normal, right? Anyway, with all the money we saved on not buying all those contrast paints, we can now buy a base set of oil paints instead. I'm mixing a turquoise, a purplish magenta, dark brown purple mix, all mixed with odorless white spirit into something of a thick wash consistency. Starting out with some pure red on the cloth, I then distribute the other colors almost as random as the previous contrast wet blend mixture, going for the dark brown on the wooden shafts, turquoise on the armor, and magenta purple in the areas that are facing down, what I would call the shaded areas. And what's the purpose of all this? Well, the first layer of paint, the dry brushed contrasts and the metallics, give me a nice base layer for something undead inspired like this. The oil paints have lovely saturation and coloration. Also with the mix of white spirit, they flow lovingly into any recesses and blend beautifully with each other, creating something that feels utterly natural and pleasing to the eye. Once I've let the oil paint set for just a minute or two, I grab some cotton buds, dip in white spirit, and gently wipe off the raised areas. The oil paint will have stained the surface somewhat, but most is removable. Cleaning up the raised areas and bringing back some of those metallics give a lovely depth to the mini. Be aware of the fact that oil paints diluted with white spirit like this dull down quite a lot when drying, so don't be afraid to overdo things. Also be aware of the fact that oil paints take quite some time to dry. Disregarding drying times, and this miniature took 5 to 10 minutes to paint. Diluting oil paint heavily with white spirit makes great washes that flow beautifully into recesses. As an example, I made some washes, giving Anubis here some more depth and a bit more of a spooky, magic-y vibe. Using oil paints like this is just so easy and rewarding. If you're intrigued by it, I recommend checking out Marco Frisoni, not just Mecca, who is somewhat of a master of all things I've tried to describe in this video, oil paints included. Finally, not immediately efficient, but for long-term efficiency, I strongly recommend varnishing miniatures. Whether you like glossy or matte, varnish out of a rattle can or brushed on with a brush, giving the paint a helping hand to stay on your miniature and not being rubbed off during gaming. If you like the look of these miniatures, please do check out the description to Storm Sunder in the description below. I've tried to mix concepts with some actual hard tips in this video, also hoping it might work as a supplement to other beginner-oriented videos, or at least giving a glance of what can be found or would be helpful to search for in the jungle, that is, YouTube. There's one last thing to consider though. Painting efficiently, to my mind, is not necessarily a beginner's technique. Just because it's fast doesn't mean it's easy. These two lovely miniatures from Storm Sunder were in some way a bigger mental challenge for me than the first, Feilheim. Painting miniatures is a craft, and any craft requires practice and repetition. So does efficiency. Making sure we enjoy that practice and that repetition is the big thing. And I sure hope some of the things in this video are things you will find enjoyable. So once more, welcome to the hobby. And don't bother to look for lifeboats. We sold them in favour for oil paints.